Yes. Well, I've been at George Washington University since 1970, so a very long time. I'm now retired from teaching, but still doing research. I got my start by writing a PhD dissertation on the space program, and in particular on the decision by President Kennedy to go to the moon. That's what I'm going to talk about at the start of this presentation. In 1987 at the university, I created something called the Space Policy Institute, which is a graduate level teaching research and professional outreach position dealing with space activities. And we've trained a lot of people, mainly Americans, but not only, to work in the space community. With international CC since its beginning in 1988, and I just gave my ISU lecture a few days ago. I've written a number of books. I'll talk about that in a few minutes. And have spent my life paying attention to the world space programs.
Okay, thanks a lot for this great resume. And maybe we can pass our question, the moon missions.
What I propose to do, I realize I'm talking to people who were not born the last time we went to the moon, and also are not familiar with the American system of government and decision making. So I'll try to be pretty basic as I go through this. I think I'm better off doing the presentation, which will take maybe 35 minutes, and then answering questions rather than stopping as I go along. Yeah, is that all right with you folks?
Yeah, that's a great plan. It's okay for us as well.
Yes, it's okay for us, I think.
Right. Okay. There seems to be about a 4 or 5 second time lag also as I am saying something and then you speak. So we'll see. I have in this presentation some video clips with sound in them. I hope they work. I've never tried it on Zoom before. So we'll find out. We'll find out rather quickly. One of the first clips is a video clip. So let me start.
Okay.
If it's going to work.
Yeah, okay.
Aha. No, it's not working. I try to advance the slide and nothing happens. Ah, there. I mean, it's a long time ago that people went to the moon. For a 4-year period between December 68 with Apollo 8 and December 1972, the United States sent 9 missions to the moon. 2 of them orbited the moon. 1 had an accident on the way out, Apollo 13, and so didn't land, and 6 landed. So 12 American astronauts walked on the moon. The last of them, Gene Cernan and Jack Schmidt, left the moon December 14th, 1972, so almost 48 years ago. And nobody has been back since. Now let's see whether this clip works. Wrong direction.
Okay, I'm going to get the pro. 99, proceeded. 3, 2, 1.
That's the
power of the ignition. Right away, Houston. Vector grid. X-side.
So, what I'm going to talk about is why did we go? Why did we stop? And will the United States or anyone else go again in your lifetime? the history part of this is based on two books I wrote in 2010 and 2015, so a few years ago now. One talking about why we went to decided to go to the moon and why we stopped. So those books are available on Amazon if anybody's ambitious to read them. The idea of sending humans to the moon was there at the very start of the American space program. NASA was created in 1958, started a long-range planning process as soon as it got started, and picked going to the moon as its long-range goal, and started planning for what it would like to do. There was a first human spaceflight program called Mercury with seven astronauts announced in 1958. The astronauts were picked in 1959. And then President Kennedy, who came into office in January of 1961, was asked, well, do we want to do something after Mercury, that decision of what the future of the program will be. So come back to me in a few months after I've had a time to get settled in and we'll talk about it. Then the Soviet Union put the first human in space, Yuri Gagarin, and on April the 12th, 1961. And the reaction around the world to Gagarin's flight was very positive. It was like Sputnik. It was a propaganda gain for the Soviet Union. And the United States and the Soviet Union at that point were engaged in a worldwide Cold War conflict for global leadership. And Kennedy, who was a very competitive person, said having the Soviet Union do everything first in space was not acceptable. He decided very quickly after Gagarin's flight that the United States had to enter and win a space race. And a few days later, he wrote this memorandum. And the key paragraph is the first one that is out in the balloon there. Do we have a chance of beating the Soviets? Is there any other space program which promises dramatic results in which we could win? Now, some of you are probably engineers and deal with requirements. This is a pretty clear requirements document. He asked to find his advisors to find a space program with dramatic results in which the United States could win, could beat the Soviet Union. And the answer came back, go to the moon. Why? Well, there was a technical reason that the Soviet Union had a very good rocket. In fact, it's still using a version of it, the Soyuz, even today. And it could do everything up to a lunar landing using that rocket. But to do a lunar landing, the Soviet Union would have to develop a new big rocket. And of course, the United States, to do a lunar landing, would have to develop a new big rocket. The United States, after World War II, had brought a bunch of... ...or German and U.S. citizens. And by 1960, von Braun was working for NASA. And it was he that said a rocket about 10 times more powerful is required to beat the Soviets to landing the first crew on the moon. The political rationale for choosing the moon is you needed humans, not just robots, to capture the imagination of the world, to symbolize to the world the power and technical capabilities of the United States. And that projects aimed at enhancing national prestige are part of the battle along the fluid front of the Cold War. And so there's there's really no doubt why Kennedy made this decision. It was a Cold War competition with the Soviet Union for global leadership. It had nothing to do about advancing technology. It had nothing to do with human exploration of the solar system. It was a competitive decision to use space as an instrument to kind of signal to the world the power of the United States. He announced his decision in this speech to our Congress, May the 25th, 1961.
The dramatic achievements in space which occurred in recent weeks should have made clear to us all, as did the Sputnik in 1957, the impact of this adventure on the minds of men everywhere who are attempting to make a determination of which road they should take. I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space.
Kennedy not only made the decision, he was willing to allocate the resources to make the decision into a real program. The NASA budget went up 89% after his speech, another 101% the next year, another 40% the following year. There was an investment more than $500 million in building facilities that we're still using today for Apollo. And the group is in size, and the contract is working on a project quadrupled, went up four times. This was like a war. It was a peaceful mobilization of human and financial resources to achieve this challenging goal. When people say, let's do another Apollo, I don't think they realize just how much money was spent in a short period of time to make the lunar landing possible. Kennedy went a year and a half after his decision to go to the moon to go out to various facilities and see what was the progress was being made. And he made in Houston on September 12th in 1962 is probably his most well-known space speech. And I'll give you a little sample of it.
Many years ago, the great British explorer George Mallory, who was to die on Mount Everest, was asked why did he want to climb it. He said, because it is there. Well, space is there, and we're going to climb it. And the moon and the planets are there, and new hopes for knowledge and peace are there. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. Thank you.
At its peak, there was the NASA budget was over 4% of the overall government budget. It's kind of like now 1/10 of that, 0.47. And it was a commitment based on before the general relations, he made this speech.
Finally, in a field where the United States and the Soviet Union have a special capacity in the field of space, there is room for new cooperation, for further joint efforts in the regulation and exploration of space.
I include among these possibilities a joint expedition to the moon.
Nikita Khrushchev, the Soviet leader, had said yes. And what if Kennedy had lived? Could they have found a basis for cooperation? Or was there really nothing that the two countries could have done together? In fact, was there really a space race? The reality was that the Soviet Union, by the time that Kennedy made that speech in 63, still had not decided to undertake a program to land cosmonauts on the moon. They didn't make that decision until 1964. So while Kennedy was alive, the United States was racing only itself. Soviet Union did make a decision to go to the moon, never provided adequate funding, could not get its big rocket. This, you see a picture of the Soviet N-1. It got off a launch pad, but then exploded. There were four launch attempts and four failures. And finally, in 1972, with the United States successfully getting to the moon, the Soviet Union quit its lunar program. So there was a space race. It was real, but the Soviet Union started behind and probably could have never caught up. Soviet Union never responded to the U.S. invitation to cooperate. We had started by 1963 a program called Gemini, two persons in a spacecraft, intended to try out the rendezvous techniques. Then, as we were getting ready for our they killed three astronauts and suggested of abandoning the program. And by 1968 was ready to start flying again. Made a remarkably bold decision to send the first flight of the big Saturn V moon rocket with a crew aboard in December of 1968 to orbit the moon. This was Apollo 8. I around the moon and brought back this iconic Earthrise picture, one of the main symbols to come out of the space program over all these years. Apollo 9 tested the lunar landing module, Apollo 10 was a dress rehearsal, and then Apollo 11. July the 16th, 1969, at Kennedy Space Center. This is the rocket after just clearing the launch tower, and in that circle is me. I was at the launch. It was a remarkable experience. I had by that time written a first book called The Decision to Go to the Moon, and that got me access to the launch. I highly recommend launches, and particularly the launches going to distant destinations like the moon. So, my there. We met Kennedy's goal, and then there was a new president, Richard Nixon, and he asked, what should we do next? And this is what the recommendation came back from NASA, was to do, not only continue to do what we're doing, but to go to Mars. If you look at the top row in this chart, you'll see the initial Mars expedition was proposed for either 1980 with lots of other, basically, NASA said, we got to the moon, now it's time to go to Mars. President Nixon was not interested in that at all. He said, no, no way of doing anything like that. In fact, 11, the decision was made not to build any more Saturn V moon rockets. And with that decision, the United States gave up its capability to do programs of human space exploration. And then decided, for a combination of budget constraints and awareness of just how risky the Apollo program was, decided, indeed, we had met President Kennedy's goal, so let's quit while we're ahead. And NASA canceled, not Nixon, NASA canceled two Apollo flights. And they had already decided to use for a 20-week Skylab. So Apollo 17 became the last mission to the moon with this decision. So you say, why did we stop? We stopped because President Nixon did not want to fund human exploration after Apollo, and NASA's leaders decided to cut short Apollo because of its high risks. Nixon issued a statement, which I call the Nixon Space Doctrine. And it has been the basic U.S. space policy since then. Space activities is a continuing process, not separate leaps like Apollo. Within a system of national priorities, competing with other things that are important to us. And in that competition, NASA has not done very well. Here's a chart of NASA's budget as a percent of the U.S. government budget. And you can see, as rapid as the buildup to Apollo was, equally rapid was the build down after Apollo. And the NASA budget has stayed at less than 1%, and now less than half of 1% of the U.S. government budget ever since. So whatever was going to be done after Apollo had to be done on far less money than was available for Apollo. Still, two presidents over a few years, President George H.W. Bush in July of 89, said time to go back to the moon, this time to stay. Then after the Columbia accident in 2003, his son, President George W. Bush, said back to the moon by 2020. If you want, we can discuss the reasons why neither of those initiatives were successful. That's the book I'm working on right now. President Obama came into office in 2009 and canceled George W. Bush's program to return to the moon, saying, we've been to the moon, let's go someplace else. And so he set out a program that said, go to an asteroid in 2025 and then go to Mars in the 2030s. This was in a speech in April of 2010. I was at the speech and got a chance to shake President Obama's hand. Interesting experience. In 2016, Donald Trump was elected our president. He reestablished a group called the National Space Council, and that council recommended a policy of returning to the moon. This is the directive he signed in December of 2017, so now almost 3 years ago. And NASA has been working to do what this says, back to the moon for long-term exploration and utilization, followed by human missions to Mars ever since. The program is called Artemis. Just a year or so ago, the vice president, Mike Pence, who's head of this National Space Council, said, let's do it by 2024. So accelerated the schedule for returning to the moon. Before Pence made his speech, it was 2028. But now we're aiming at a program called Artemis to get people back to the moon in 2024. This is the most recent good quality chart I could find. The reality is that the program is being revised as we speak. But you see that the idea is to launch Artemis 1 probably toward the end of next year, 2021, as a test without a crew of the big new rocket and the big new spacecraft. I'll talk about them in a minute. Then to fly around the moon on the Artemis in 2023 is the current plan. Then perhaps build an outpost in lunar orbit as a staging base called the Gateway, or maybe not, that's being debated. And then on Artemis 3 to fly a woman and a man, first woman and the next man, to the lunar surface by the end of 2024. That's the current plan. I'll talk a little bit about its condition. To do that, we have built a big new rocket like the Saturn V called the Space Launch System. The rocket is pretty well built. It has a test, ground test, scheduled for later this year, with the idea of its first launch without a crew aboard next year. This is not quite as powerful as the Saturn V, but still almost as big and almost as powerful. And we've built a new spacecraft designed to carry crew beyond low Earth orbit. So this is not the spacecraft carrying crew to the space station. This is a different craft called Orion. Four-person crew. It's been tested in an early flight now in 2014, then nothing until a late 2021 test flight for the crew on the Artemis II mission. In order to get to the moon, we need something to land on the moon. We haven't figured out what that something is. That's the current kind of sticking point. The Trump administration asked for a $3 billion addition to the NASA budget to build a human landing spacecraft. So far, our Congress has not provided the craft. And obviously, we're not going to get back to the moon, certainly not by 2024, until a decision is to build and the Congress provides the funding to build it. Hard now is plans, a competition. There are several companies compete to build the land. No money to do it. So that's more or less where we are. What about happen sometime after 2030 in courts? There are a lot of private companies and groups planning on sending robotic spacecraft to the moon, but only very rich people like Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos have plans to send people beyond Earth orbit. Musk has focused on sending people to Mars. Bezos has focused on getting people in orbiting outposts working in space, millions of people, he says. But they all have moon in their plans. It's conceivable that they could be, especially if our government does not fund NASA to do its mission. That one of these billionaire programs could be first, I think that won't happen. I think it is the United States government that will lead the first return to the moon. And so it's fair to ask 50 years after Apollo, will another moment like Kennedy's decision to go to the moon come again? Is it coming? Let me close with these famous words from Kennedy's September 1962 Houston speech.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and the others too.
All right. That's what I have to say. Did it come through okay?
Yeah, it's
hello.
Yeah. We had a few questions about the presentation. First of all, I actually wondered about as you said that in the past it was like a competition between Russia and USA, but what do you think about now? Is it still same? Is it like a competition for Mars mission or moon missions? Like,
no, as I said, only the United States now is putting money to build the system to return to the moon. China has said it is during the 20s, during this decade, building a small space station, and only after 2030 will it pay attention to sending people to the moon. So I don't think that there is a competition.
For a moon mission and the Mars mission, there are a lot of differences, actually. For example, the distance and the situation is too different. For example, when we send astronauts to moon, it's closer and maybe it's it will not be more harmful like going to Mars. And firstly, we are trying with the robots, and but as the moon missions, we are thinking to have a human mission with humans.
Yeah,
do you think it will be possible?
I'm sorry, you're breaking up. I'm only hearing.
Do you think it will
I'm
be?
I'm only hearing about half of what you're saying. If I understand your question, it's the difference between going to the moon and going to Mars.
Yes.
I mean, the moon is easy. It's only 3 days away. Mm. Mars, with current propulsion, as we know from the three missions that were just launched, is 6 or 7 months away. I think realistically to plan for sending humans to Mars, we will have to develop nuclear propulsion and cut down the travel to a month or two. There have been plans to do that, but the plans have not been funded. Now, a month or two sounds like a long time for a trip, but the explorers of old that explored the world back centuries ago were away from their home port for months at a time. A 2 month trip to Mars is not all that long, as long as you can keep people healthy, keep them shielded from radiation. If you provide artificial gravity or not, because you want them to be able to work when they get there or function when they get to Mars. And we discovered 2 months in zero gravity affects your ability to work. That's one of the reasons we have these long duration stays on the International Space Station. There's a lot of work to do before we're ready to go to Mars.
Yes. Do you think it will be a close date, or I mean the close time, or as I know that it will be around 2013? 2030 and 33, maybe.
Well, I mean, the last president that set a date was Obama in 2010.
Yes, right.
There's a very good opportunity in 2033 where the trajectory between the Earth and Mars is a bit shorter than at other opportunities. So there's a lot of people that think we should at least try to orbit Mars in 2033. I don't think on our current schedule and pace that is realistic. When people ask me when Mars, I say late 2030s, early 2040s at the earliest. So I don't expect to be around to see it.
And I wonder, what is the plan for the protection of human body from the radiation? And also the body of women will be resist for the situation in Mars?
Well, in terms of protection against radiation, that's a research focus right now with no answer. I mean, we haven't designed a spacecraft, therefore we haven't designed its radiation protection system. There are lots of different ideas of how to do that, and those are the decisions that have to be made before any kind of formal decision that we're ready to go to Mars. There's plenty of research for young scientists and engineers to do from all over the world.
Oh yeah. And the next question is actually about the next destination. Okay, we went to Moon, and after that we said, okay, we went to Moon and we have to go to another different place, and also we made a Mars plan. And what about after Mars? What is the next destination?
Well, I have a colleague who has written a book that argues is Mars is the last place we can go, that there is no other destination that is technically feasible for humans to travel to. So that's one extreme answer, is Mars is it. Then, of course, there are people that talk about the moons of Jupiter. But we can't go to Jupiter because there's no solid surface. We can't really go to an asteroid because most of them are too small. You don't land on them, you rendezvous with them. So whether there is another realistic destination, whether it's a moon of Jupiter or Saturn, and what kind of propulsion system you're talking about to get those distances, I think still are science fiction, not science. I mean, there are people thinking about it, but I think they think about it mainly for their own entertainment, not because it's a serious idea.
And also, it's been said that Titan also very close to world Earth, and there is existence of water as well. Do you think that will be a next destination for living of humankind?
Well, depends on what you mean by living. We have thousands of people spending the winter in Antarctica in very cold and uncomfortable circumstances. I could see certainly scientific outposts on the moon and perhaps even Mars, with living there on a long-term basis. Whether we get to the point of large human settlements on either the moon or Mars, I think depends on the answer to a couple of questions. I mean, are there things there that you can build an economy around? You know, is there a way to create a lunar economy so that people have jobs and can make a living? And can you live off the land? Can you learn to feed yourself and take care of yourself with local resources so you don't have to import everything from Earth? If the answer to those two questions is yes, that there's an economic basis for being there and that you can pretty much live off the land, then that's a possibility. But the reason we're going to explore is to get answers to those questions. We don't know those answers yet. A lot of people speculate about it, but we haven't really tried.
Yes, that's great. And also, when you talk about asteroids, I really wondered about this thing. And okay, for the next destination, we said maybe it will be impossible after Mars. But maybe we can jump onto an asteroid. Do you think that asteroid can be like a vehicle to space? Because the asteroid is not fixed in a place. It's always moving. And maybe we can use
it. No, everything's always moving.
Yeah, that's right. But I mean, for moving to somewhere else. Yeah, it's moving like straightforward, and maybe we can go on it and move to somewhere, like a vehicle of space, like a spaceship.
Yeah, no, I understand what you're saying. Let's first say there are two groups of asteroids. I mean, they're the asteroids in the belt between Mars and Jupiter, and they're in fixed orbit. And they're orbiting the sun just like the planets are orbiting the sun. And some of them are pretty large. Then there are these so-called near-Earth objects, which really are on an orbit. It's just not a circular orbit around the sun. And so indeed, they're almost relatives of comets. So they can be on very different orbits. And that's what you're saying. Could you establish a colony, a settlement, or a few people on one of those asteroids and ride it on its orbit? And yeah, the answer is yes, but why? What would be, most of them would be commitments of your life. You're not coming back anytime soon. People. And I'm welcome to them. What's down here in the chat room?
I have a question from one friend I want to ask you. And she asks she wants to ask you about the level of civilizations. What do you think about the levels of civilizations? I think she asks about, for example, maybe there are a lot of another type of life in another galaxy, maybe. And what is, maybe their technology will be upper than us, maybe lower than us. And according to the universe, what is the level of humankind in the civilization?
Well, first of all, it's not humankind. If they're different things than humans.
Yeah, I mean the human on the Earth. What is the level of them according to other entities?
Well, ask them.
Interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's much more likely that there is a life of microbes or bacteria or small organisms than there is likelihood of advanced forms of life and intelligence more than humans. I think humanity is pretty advanced. I think it's arrogant to think that we are the top form of life in the universe, because we don't know. There could well be other forms of intelligence, other forms of life technologically much more advanced than humanity. And then, you know, where are they? Are they here? Are they visiting us? Have they taken a look at Earth and said, I don't want to go there? So, those are fascinating questions. And we almost every week find more planets around other stars in other galaxies, only in our galaxy so far. But we know there are billions of galaxies. So the idea that human life is unique. If you know some religions think that, from a purely rational point of view, I think that's kind of arrogant.
Okay, I have another question from other friends of us. She asks you some advices, actually. What do you advise for the youngs in Turkey who wants to follow the path of science and technology? What do you advise to young people?
Yeah, I'm sorry you broke up there.
Okay, I can ask that. One of our friends wanted to ask you about your advices. What's your advice to young people?
See if you can repeat the question again.
Okay, she asked that, what do you advise to young people who wants to grow up and go to the path of the science and technology?
I think she is gone, but I have a question to ask, actually.
Okay. Take advice, but as much as possible, I hope you will contribute to the technical base of your country and to engage Turkey with other in other areas of science and technology, rather than leave, other than maybe little education in other places in the world. This kind of group that you form is an important step to bringing like-minded people together to encourage one another, exchange experiences, learn from each other, and push your to do cutting edge things in science and engineering.
I want to ask another question about the missions. Do you hear me, sir? Does everyone hear me?
Now I lost it.
Okay. Until now, when we checked the missions to Moon and space, always we've seen that the man astronauts are chosen. And what is the reason behind this thing? Why the astronauts, the man, as chosen in missions, and why not women?
Not only men. Well, there are not enough women, but the current U.S. plan is that the first woman on the moon, first person to return to the moon, will be a woman. On the next crew going to the space station, there is a woman. There are a number of females in the U.S. astronaut corps, a few in the Japanese astronaut group, not many in the Russian, a few, did I say, in the European group. Women in space is to push the various countries or organizations that choose astronauts to choose qualified women candidates. In the last, I'm going to get my number wrong here, but the last group of astronauts, I think it was 12 people, and 7 of them were women. There were more women than men. So there are opportunities.
Okay, I got it. And I also wonder, when we ask about this question, I also wonder about the two things. Firstly, as the human body, do you think there is a difference between men and women body to resist to a space situation? I mean, the space problems.
Well, you know, one thing where women have an advantage is that they're by and large smaller. I mean, clearly radiation would have different effects on females than males. And there is an issue of whether there are threats to reproductive capability in women in long duration flights. So that's an issue. So yes, there are differences, but you can account for those differences. There have been women staying for 6 months on the space station and coming back and leading very normal lives.
So let me,
I think it's time for me to quit. So I will send you, Elif, a copy of my presentation.
That would be great.
Share. And there is my email address on that presentation.
Yes.
So anybody should feel free to send an email if they have additional questions. Is that okay?
Yes, it's okay. We would be happy for that.
All right. Well, then let's end for today. Thank you all for paying attention.
Yeah. Thanks a lot for being for spending your
good
time.
Luck.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.